Okay, welcome to the lecture on underwater mortgages. Now leave it to an economist to come up with a title like that. Now this is a phrase that only became popularized really after the 2008 financial collapse. And the reference that it's making is not to people taking their mortgages and throwing them in the swimming pool, but rather that people were literally, you know, up to their neck in debt, and the value of their assets, their homes, were below the level of what they actually owed. So let's take a look at what was happening before the financial crisis. Now remember, there was a lot of confidence in the housing market, and almost anybody and their brother was able to get a mortgage, right? And that's, of course, part of the problem. This has been alluded to in previous lectures that we've had on the financial crisis. But let's just assume that you bought a house for $180,000, and you bought it in, let's say, you know, 2005, and all is well, at least on the surface. And in 2006, it appreciates to $190,000. In 2007, it's appreciating up to, you know, $200,000. Great. So now you actually have positive equity, right? In addition to equity that you've built up from paying part of the principal down. Now, of course, after 2 years, you wouldn't have paid down that much principal, but you have, right? So, great. So $200,000 would be the market value if you logged on to HAR.com and you checked out what homes in your neighborhood were selling for. That's what you were looking at. And so everything looks good, right? But then what happens is, in 2008, as a lot of these subprime mortgages began to go belly up, that is, people who had borrowed money to get mortgages, who had less than stellar credit, or in fact, in some cases, downright bad credit, started to lose their jobs, they couldn't make their payments anymore. And so what happens when you can't make your payments? The mortgage company or the bank will repossess your home and then sell it on the open market, because financial companies like banks are not really in the business of owning people's homes. They're in the business of lending money and making profits through interest. So all this stock of housing hit the market all at once. It depressed the prices of homes. And let's say so badly that now that $180,000 home goes down to $160,000. Now, for you who is still lucky enough to have a job, this doesn't affect you, at least except for on paper. That is, your net worth has declined. If you're still making your payments, you still enjoy your home, you have a roof over your head, and you're still able to put nails in the wall and hang up, you know, pictures and do whatever else you've been doing, right? But you have experienced a net decline in your net worth. There's no question about that. And in fact, you don't have any equity anymore. In fact, you have, you know, negative equity, because if you had to sell your house right now, you'd only be able to get 160 for it, and you still owe 180. So you're sort of upside down in your mortgage. Hence the phrase underwater mortgage. You're underwater, right? So this is the water line way up here. This is how much you owe, and down here is, you know, how much the value of the house is if you were to trade it on the market. But if you're not going to do anything, you're fine. You can just wait it out. In fact, if you just got married and you had some kids and you're laying down roots in the neighborhood and you have a good paying job, that's fine. You can afford to sort of wait it out. So for you, it's okay, although it's discouraging to see the value of your home decline and your net worth decline. And maybe it does affect you in some ways, because maybe when it was worth $200,000, your spouse wanted you to build a backyard patio, a covered patio, and have a nice, you know, outdoor kitchen out there. And maybe you were going to borrow some of this money from the bank for a second mortgage so that you could do that. Well, now you can't do that because you don't have any equity. So it has affected you to some level, but it's not nearly as catastrophic as everybody else who lost their jobs. Now, what about somebody who's taking a look at what's happening with government intervention? Now, if you'll recall, in the early years of the financial crisis, in fact, in the early months of the financial crisis, the government rushed in, you know, almost in a panicky sort of way, and it's understandable, at least at some degree, of the government wanting to try to mitigate the damage that was being done in terms of the free fall of the housing prices in the market, wanted to do something to relieve folks of some of the burden. And the foreclosure rate was going up pretty dramatically, and the new administration wanted to do something kind of to stop the bleeding. And it is something that was very noble, but also had some unintended negative consequences. So what was this policy? Well, what it was is a little bit of relief. And that is, there were programs in place, and many of the banks were being encouraged by the government. And in fact, more than just encouraged, almost sort of had a little bit of arms twisting taking place, because of course some of these banks have been bailed out by the government. And they were being told, Bank of America, many other lending institutions, look, if somebody is getting in a bind and they're behind in the loan, we're going to set aside a certain amount of money whereby you can negotiate with the borrower for different terms. So, for example, it's a 30-year mortgage, and it was 5 years ago, and they're in danger of default because they're 2 months behind on their payment, then what you can do is step in and say, okay, I tell you what, we'll redo your mortgage, and now it's over 30 years again instead of the 25 that's left on it, and that'll lower the monthly payment. And if that's enough to be able to get them to be able to continue making their payments, great. And so those people are helped in a very material way. Now, in some cases, it may be even tougher than that. There might have to be a little bit of debt forgiveness. So you might discount part of what is owed and renegotiate the loan again over more favorable terms, or perhaps lowering the interest rate. All of this, of course, costs the bank money. And in many cases where the government was ponying up part of these losses, it's costing the taxpayers money. But that's not really the end of it. What about some guy, we'll just, you know, call him Joe Smith for now, is saying to himself, look, I'm a hardworking guy. I'm an electrician. I'm paying all my bills dutifully. I'm meeting my mortgage payments. And there's these other folks out there that have been in default and, you know, not paying their mortgage, and they're getting help. And he's dutifully paying his mortgage and not getting any help, but he's also in a tough spot as well, right? It's not like the recession has left him unscathed. After all, some of his business has gone down a bit as a result of all these massive layoffs that were, you know, a concomitant part of the 2008 financial meltdown. So this guy, you know, gets on the red line and calls this 1-800 number that the government has set up and says, hey, look, I'd like to talk about getting some help from this new government program that's going to provide me with perhaps a little bit of relief, or maybe lower my interest payments, or forgive some of my principal on my mortgage. Sounds great. And they'll ask you a series of questions. Well, you know, how many months are you behind on your mortgage? And you say no. And what's your income? Are you making any income? And you declare your income. And they go through a whole host of questions, and within a matter of just a few minutes, determine you don't need any help. And you say, well, how come? Because, well, you're making income, and you've been making your mortgage payments. So this guy just feels like he's just been kicked in the teeth. So he hangs up, and then he thinks to himself, gee, I know a way that I can make this work. What if I just stop paying a mortgage, and I'll just take that money and just put it in a safe deposit box? And I'll do this for a few months until, you know, foreclosure proceedings commence. And then I can call the 1-800 number. Well, it's not like hundreds of thousands or millions of people were doing that, but certainly significant number of people were doing that. And so this set up a scenario that economists refer to as moral hazard. In fact, moral hazard is probably one of those concepts that before the 2008 crash occurred, most lay people had never heard of, let alone knew what it even really meant. But a moral hazard is a situation in which one party is engaged in behavior that if the other party knew about, would try to stop, right? And it's doing damage to that other party. It's kind of like even in a worker-employer relationship, right? If a worker's kind of goofing around and not doing his job, well, that's hurting the employer. If the employer knew about it, well, the employer could do something about it, lower his wage or maybe worse, ratchet it up and fire the guy, right? But he doesn't know about it. So that's a moral hazard. In this case, we've set up a moral hazard in the sense that the rescue effort provided an incentive for other people who weren't necessarily in a bad way to take advantage of it, and they did so, right? So they got behind on their mortgages, they qualified, and then of course, you know, this caused the program to become even that much more costly as a result of that. So the bottom line is the program certainly had some unintended consequences, and this is another reason why it's very important not to rush to come to an economic solution to a problem, and also to make sure that we think through what are the sort of the secondary and tertiary effects of this rescue plan. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this little mini lecture, and until next time, we'll see you.